Bienvenidos, ForzaRC fans. Welcome to Mexico City. With the Forza Racing Championship Series 2 playoffs just days away, we've got the latest on the playoffs, plus some exciting bonus races. And we'll be hearing from JSR Commando and the FLG about an exciting new project. Although we are just kicking off our playoff weekend in Mexico City, some of us have been checking out the sights and sounds with a local Forza aficionado. And let me tell you, things got heated. We hope you like it spicy, because this is a Series 2 Playoffs preview show.
The Forza Racing Championship Series 2 playoffs are coming to Mexico City as we race through the decades. We flash back 40 years to the return of a champion in the 70s. Chaos would ensue in the 80s as heroes would falter. But it was the 90s that gave us showdowns worthy of the decade. And the new millennium would set the grid for Mexico City. The future is now. Who will prevail in the modern era as we've raced through 40 years of motorsports to this very moment?
It's the Series 2 playoffs in Mexico City, September 29th and 30th. You can tune in at watch.forzarc.com.
Welcome to Mexico City. We are live as we are kicking it off, as we are really taking it to the Series 2 playoffs, which I couldn't be more excited about. I think Ali Tack, Scott Cole would agree with that. Some of us have been here for a few days already, and those have been us. Scott Cole, favorite part so far?
We've been to a few restaurants. We've done some damage down here in Mexico City. All good, all delicious. So that's my favorite part so far, but really looking forward to the racing.
You know, I loved going around the market. We saw some cool cars parked up against the curb. Lots of sort of interesting rust buckets that they had around here. But yeah, a great car culture out here in Mexico.
You know, I love the murals and the arts that we're seeing. And of course, right behind us, we have an incredible view of Mexico City. We have the Castle Chapultepec. I'm still working on my Spanish as I go along. That means a grasshopper mountain, of course. As we are kicking off everything here this week, we want to make sure you know that you can get involved in our show by going to watch.forzarc.com. But more importantly, you get a chance to complete those quests and earn some rewards, including one of these bad boys.
Not a bad Beamer right there.
Ooh, very nice indeed. Yeah, I love that GT2 M3, I should say. Also, the older Porsche.
I'm okay with that.
I'm a fan of the GTR, guys. You can go street side with that thing.
Oh, well, there's your priority.
Hit it on the street. I'll take all the rewards.
I'll take all of them.
And of course, you have to look good to drive good, if you will, in these karate suits. That, my friends, that looks pretty fantastic. What do you think?
Yeah, I don't know if you do karate, but that suit is kicking.
Well, of course, the best way to win this karate suit is to go to watch.forzarc.com, retweet your favorite tweet on the Twitter panel. Scott, that's super easy to do.
Oh, yeah, I do it every week because I mentioned before, I want all the rewards, and it literally takes 2 seconds.
Yeah, I mean, if
just
you can
log in, and if you want to, you know, get your Microsoft account in there, your Xbox account, boom, they send it right to you. Pretty good surprise to go home to every time we're done here.
Well, we have 36 drivers coming here to Mexico City this weekend for the Series 2 playoffs. But one thing that I know that we're all very excited about is see the LATAM representation. We have 7 drivers from the LATAM group.
Yeah, I mean, what an incredible achievement from the region. I mean, maybe 2 years ago, LATAM was trailing a little bit compared to EMEA, compared to North America. But now, wow, what a change for LATAM.
Well, it's all about Zoom, you know, and HardBR not only being on the top, but I think he's been a real inspiration to that region. And with us being on their home turf, look for them to perform well this weekend.
Well, another driver that I'm quite excited to see perform is Wesley. He's one that we haven't seen. He's making his first appearance. And I think the conversation really stands true of how do these guys perform differently being in the comfort of their own home versus that of being here against their competitors.
I think there's a lot more pressure. You know, you get in a land environment, some cream will rise to the top, others will fall away, and it's just due to that pressure of able to reach out and touch somebody, it just makes it a whole different scenario than, you know, eating Cookie Crisp in your pajamas playing.
I'm just super excited to see Wesley play. I mean, I was on the same team as Wesley for a long time on Forza, you know, and now he's changed over to TX3, and yeah. I just can't wait to see him really perform in an LAN event. What a great chance.
Well, we know Series 2 has developed a lot of stories that I know are going to come to a head this weekend and, of course, then on in London. But what are two, from both of you, what are your favorite storylines at this point in the season?
Well, I got to go North America for me. I mean, it's all about Force One. This is a guy that really is an up-and-comer. I mean, we could be seeing the next Lage, the next dominant guy out in our series, in our circuit. And as he builds the confidence and has that aggression, look for him to really maybe even take Group 1. And that's tough with Zoom and Roadrunner both in that group.
I'm looking to Group 2. One of the most interesting people I'm looking at in this playoff is JSR South, 8th place there on the grid in Group 2. It's his first offline event. We talked about that with Wesley already, but that will be a very different South that we see. A lot of the community know him as a fast driver, but how will that change the way he drives?
You know, well, I think one of the most impressive things that I saw out of the season already was F4H, and when they were with us at the promo show a couple of Wednesdays ago, I thought it was so significant to see them come in there and really take part in being not in the comfort of their own home. But the main person that I was so impressed with was Sterilizer. It was his first time traveling, and he came in guns a-blazing, if you will, as it relates to his performance, and even won that first race. And I thought that was really, really special.
They're a team that's have gone through a lot of changes, but when you saw that core group come in, you know that each of them, like iron sharpens iron, they're really looking to make each other better, especially here in Mexico.
I mean, Sterilizer is a brave cool. He's one of the lowest seeded drivers coming into the competition. The only way is up for him, of course, from there. But yeah, I mean, not a favorite for me.
He's a tough group. That's a tough group in group three.
Yeah.
No doubt about it.
You know it's a tough group sometimes? You guys. But you know also, speaking of the tough group, you guys also offer so much valid and a very important insight that each and every one of these Wednesdays I look forward to hearing.
When you look at that racing, it was like driving a potato. I mean, this is a car that was built for really red light to red light. By the way, make sure you get yourself a ham sandwich because the adjudication process for this one is going to be a tremendous one. Autumn coming around the corner. There's no better place to go than Maple Valley. By the way, the syrup there is delicious.
Get your headset back on. What's this about? Come on.
Talking to Roadrunner over here.
Yeah, you're trying to talk to Roadrunner about sparkles, apparently.
Brian and I were going to make a Chick-fil-A run, and I just started thinking about it. And then I'm talking to Roadrunner in the chat about all hell sparkles. Now Billy Sue once again is in a JSR sandwich.
Yeah, Rossi out in front, JSR second, TX3 third, and JSR fourth.
Well, let's see, what would be in a JSR sandwich? The J is either like a jam or jelly, right?
Yeah.
I'm okay with that. That's a good start to a sandwich. Jelly, salad, and raisins. Sounds delicious. What kind of bread are we using with that?
Rye.
Rye bread?
Uh-huh.
Oh, the JSR sandwich. That is one that not only got a couple laughs that day, but I'm really thinking we need a little up close and personal look at what this JSR sandwich is all about. And Allie, I think you can give us the full launch on it. Lunch.
The full lunch.
I think I'm hungry.
What were the ingredients again in the JSR sandwich?
I think
we're talking jam.
Jelly. I went with jelly. Jelly was my first go, but you can call it jam, sure.
We've got the R. That's raisins.
Ours raisins, but it's all about what you put in the middle. Salad. I said salami, which seemed to be something you would want to eat, and you're like, no, I like to put a salad on a sandwich.
It doesn't sound too bad to me.
You guys could have come up with something so much better than that. You guys are racers. You're not foodies. That's what it comes down to, right? Well, let's take a closer look at what this is in real life. I think, Allie, it kind of makes everything, makes your mouth water, doesn't it?
Yeah, this is the JSR sandwich right here.
That makes my mouth water, that bread.
We're talking a crusty loaf right there. Slice it right open.
You gotta see what's under the hood.
Exactly. Everything power in this sandwich, there's jelly. We talked about that. You wanna spread it on thick.
Yeah, you gotta start with the jam. I mean, it's, you need that, you know, that cohesion that brings it all together. But then the salad?
It's a bright note.
It is a bright note.
It cuts through the jelly. The sweetness of the jelly, contrasted with the fresh bitterness of the salad, gives you absolute power. You can see this JSR sandwich just ready to roll, ready to head out from the pits.
My question is when you guys were talking about the JSR sandwich on air, does this what you envisioned it to be?
This will haunt my nightmares.
It's so beautiful.
The tunes going along with this makes it that much. At least it's on that plate. It's Mexico City at the plate.
I'm crying right now. There's tears rolling down my cheeks. This is too beautiful.
It's all about the chassis.
Oh, my goodness.
That is a crusty chassis right there. You want a crusty chassis, a little bit of stiffness for the corners.
What track would that be the best on? I don't know. I feel like it's going to be real tasty.
My digestive track, I think.
Well played, my friend. All right, we know how much you guys love racing. We want to make sure we take it to the track and not your digestive track first and foremost. But Scott, I think there's something waiting for you right there.
I'm going to let Allie open it up.
Because it's a cloche. A cloche appeared. How did that happen?
He's the chef.
All right, are you ready for this? I mean, maybe there could be some smoke, a drum
roll.
Like
sure.
We're just going to do it. Oh, look at all.
That is disgusting.
It's beautiful. What you can't see on the screen is the smell, and it's a rich smell. That's a powerful
aroma. It's a very
aroma.
Powerful.
Pungent.
Chafing
How
on the nostrils.
How about my digestive track now? Oh my gosh, it's even worse.
I tell you what, though, I will go in for a raisin, though.
You got to go in for more than the raisin. You come for the raisins, you stay for the salad.
You got to start. Yeah, it's like a palate cleanser before you get going.
Yeah, well, get going.
I can't even.
I don't think so.
Anyway,
hard pass.
We know how much you all love racing. We want to make sure we give you your fill, as we have our fill here of this sandwich. We want to make sure you have your fill of racing as well. Let's go ahead and kick it off with a race number one here today.
You got it. We got four teams, two races, three drivers. We did this a couple weeks ago up in Seattle. We had F4H, and you know about the bonus points. It's all about the team score, though. I mean, we deal so much in the individual nature, Allie, but when you get your team together, it's as many points as you get, it's all key.
And it's such a different type of driving as well, team driving compared to individual driving. They can help each other out on track. You can see here F4H will have three drivers all being able to help each other out, Sterilizer, Diablo, and Revs. And they'll be not just jockeying position for themselves, but also trying to maybe make a few gaps for their teammates.
So JSR, they are so tough when it comes to these team competitions with Type R, Commando, and Craviator. Of course, Craviator, we'll see him this weekend. Moving on to our third team, TPR, Chemical, Davy Skills, and Zermatt. Actually, when you look at these teams, that's not bad. And TX3 just comes with a couple, at some point you have to reward people from being around all season.
You do, exactly. And, you know, bring them up into the top. I mean, that's a little bit harsher, maybe. A couple of those guys, I think all three of them actually didn't qualify for the Mexico playoffs. But yeah, a nice reward for them to come out and race in this team competition. I'm loving seeing them.
So those are the four teams. We're going to have a couple races here in Mexico City. Are you going in?
I'm going in. I mean, for all of you guys who are squeamish about chewing sounds, rip.
Well,
ASMR at its finest.
That is not a fine sandwich.
So what's the jelly? What flavor is that?
I don't know. It's
terrible.
Hell flavor. It's the flavor that would serve you in hell.
I'm literally
going to
be smelling you, Allie, for the next hour. Scott and I are.
I don't like being able to smell myself.
Anyways,
I will concur with that.
Well, of course, in these team races, they have to play for something, and that is, are you ready? You drum roll for you're eating that sandwich. Drum roll for this. It's a Forza Horizon 4 that obviously the demo was released earlier in the month, Friday. The early access drops, and then this weekend, it's a big day, and everybody is looking forward to it because, of course, seasons change everything.
Ultimate Edition and play 4 days early.
I was totally vibing with that.
We're all kind of getting down a little bit, shaking it. It's awesome.
So excited for everyone to have access to that October 2nd. Make sure you get everything you need for Forza Horizon 4. All right, let's get to the track. It's time to go racing. Gentlemen, take it away.
All right, here we go. Race number one of the day. A little team racing and, oh boy.
Oh boy.
Here we go. The F-150 and the Brat-a-tat-tat are going to get out there. And boy, we've seen some, actually out of both of these beasts, we've seen some incredible team racing thus far.
We were talking about trains, planes, and automobiles earlier on today, and talking of odd couples. Here is a very, very heavy track, heavy trophy truck, and a very light little brat that's going to be very nimble in the corners. So one's fast in the straights, one's nimble in the corners.
Well, the track they're going to be on is Hockenheimring, the full circuit. What do you think about this track, Alec?
I like the Hockenheimring. You know, it's a newer layout, changed in 2002. You used to head off into the woods at turn two, but now you can see it here. It veers off onto a long straight in the carousel. The final sector is very tricky indeed. The stadium section is very grippy, and that's where you're going to see the Brat make up a big advantage.
All right, here's the grid, the 12 that we're going to send out there. Once again, reminder, it is team racing. And there's, you talked about Serializer earlier. He's there at number two. Zermatt there in three. At the bottom, it's going to be Commando. So that's how we're going to start here on the grid. And watch out for Craviator there in eighth.
Craviator's always a mover, isn't he? And always a little bit of an unknown quantity. The other drivers will be maybe a little bit cautious driving around him. I'm looking forward to seeing Ty Power on track as well. It's not every day you see him representing JSL.
So two cars, three drivers. You get to see which they will duplicate. And here we go. We are green on Hockenheimring. Full circuit, seven laps, and you can see already that F-150, and we got a little bit, a little bit of carnage going through that first turn.
Not too bad. Commando still there at the rear of the pack, with the top four remaining the same. Zermatt, Papai up there in the lead of the race. We're on board with Sterilizer, looking forward for fifth.
All right, so Papai run around in second, on board real quick with a Brad sandwich. We've already had a JSR earlier. This is TX3, Mr. Jack right along in third.
Ooh, and that's Pat for the big spin there. The JSR crew couldn't afford that. Early on in this race, we talked about how a few of those drivers were maybe ranked a bit lower, and already coming a crop of Paps and Papai.
Now you see they're in eighth and ninth and 10th. So Papai started out at the top of the grid, had the pole position. He's already falling all the way down close to our final three drivers here in the first lap. And Ali, you can see the power of the F-150, but how about that nimbleness of the Brat?
You can see it throwing it, aggressive moves up the inside of the corners. We're on board here with the fourth place TX3 Brat on the straights. Yep, the trophy truck's gonna disappear, but it's the end of the lap. The section we're coming up to now where the Brat is really gonna be able to set fire, and you can see around the outside the Diablo, gutsy move.
You can already see those F-150s having problems with the back end sliding out, and we've seen the Brat a time or two get up on two wheels as Diablo just did there in second place as he's trying to chase down revs in this first lap of seven. I'd like to welcome you guys in. Of course, we're broadcasting live from Mexico City, getting ready for the weekend, the Series 2 playoffs, starting out with a little fun team racing.
Team racing is always such an enjoyable thing to watch. I love the way the cars interact with each other, especially when we've got such a different pairing of cars like this, a massive trophy truck and a little Brat. I've got to tell you, all of these teams have elected, they all have to have one of each car at least, there's three drivers in each team, all elected to have two trophy trucks apart from TX3. Not working out for TX3. They're way back right now.
Yeah, and I think that was a bit of a misnomer. They took a little bit of a risk there, but it hasn't paid off. And they go across the start finish line one more time. Diablo is your man out in front in that Brat as Revs, aka Paul, will chase down. And Revs goes wide to the outside. He's going to have to watch himself coming back on the track, end up losing a position, dropping down to third, trying to hold that second. But there's the power that you saw. He fell back to third, but the power of that F-150, able to bring him back in second as you see a little bit of wheel spin.
The character of these cars is so different, so interesting to watch. F4H right now are looking super strong, kind of blockading out one and two. Diablo's in the lead in the Brat, Revs running rear gunner in that much heavier trophy truck. It's JSR Type R though, running in third, who's gonna be looking to find a way past this F4H twosome.
Zermatt right behind him. There's Craviator in fifth. He's already moved up three spots, running a 209 through that first lap, looking to improve on it here. And we're going to have another change in the lead between. You're on the same team.
It may be the fastest way around this track, to be honest. I mean, you don't want to have to wait for the trophy truck in the corners, and the trophy truck doesn't want to have to wait for the brat on the straight. So swapping around all over the place, rude from Zermatt.
Yeah, a little bit of testing the track limits here, especially from Revs, as he goes wide again. He is having a tough time with that F-150, and he won't be able to recover this time as he falls all the way back to sixth place.
I think that is a really important point in this race. Revs falling back from second place and breaking that F4H blockade at the front. Hypar is now able to attack Diablo uninhibited, that's a hard word to say.
And it felt like it was coming from Revs over those last couple turns through lap one, a little bit of lap two, where he would step going wide and wide and wide. Why is it so tough keeping this F-150 on the track?
I mean, you can see the car suffers a lot from body roll, the very soft suspension, leaning the weight of the car onto the outside tires. Some drivers will be great at dealing with that. Revs, somebody who's not so able to adjust his driving style to make that, to mitigate that weakness in the car. And look at this, Type R already attacking Diablo.
Type R, I didn't see this coming in, that he was gonna be one of the guys up in front. He's proved us wrong over the first three laps as he's looking really strong. Diablo right behind him. And Diablo sort of had that security blanket with Revs up there. Once he fell back, now Diablo is maybe looking for a bit of a different line as he goes around Hockenheimring.
As you say, a security blanket. He had security for a little while. He was relaxed. He was finding more pace. That's water on the lens. I'm seeing it while I'm saying it. That's exciting. He found more pace when he was relaxed. When Revs fell off the track behind Diablo, yeah, he started to push a little bit too hard, I think. But water's going to change everything.
Well, it is rainy down here in Mexico City. It's a rainy season, about 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock every day. You get a little bit of rain, so why not introduce it here on Hockenheimring? If you're wondering the difference in the horsepower between these two trucks, as just for a moment, Diablo trying to hold it all together. At one point was leading this race, has fallen to fourth. It is 450 horsepower on that F-150, Ellie, and just 175 on the Brat.
That low amount of horsepower on the Brat means you have to be perfect in the corners. And we're on board here with Diablo. You can see he's running too hot into the corners. He's struggling on corner exit, bumping into other cars.
That was his teammate, Paul, by the way, AKA Revs.
Bumping into his teammate, exactly. Shows it, you know, not purposeful, not running into on purpose, but knocking out his teammate. It's all about feel in this weather. You have to listen to your front tires, listen to everything, and just be super, super aware of what your car is doing. So Diablo, not able to do that so easily.
Now that the precipitation's coming down, which of these vehicles do you think is going to start performing well in this middle part of this race?
Look at this. I mean, we've got a blockade here of super trucks running from second to fourth, and that might be your answer. The super trucks beginning to bubble to the surface now that the track's becoming a little bit glossy. Big puddles aren't yet forming, although they probably will in some small amount of time. Chemical getting bullied by Brats there. Yeah, you hate to see it.
Well, now he's going to trade some paint with Diablo. Chemical there in fifth position, representing TPR. A little team racing. First of two races coming your way today. And of course, we'll be racing for days this weekend. Literally, it's going to be amazing to see these 36 drivers ascend onto Mexico City. And I say ascend because we're at about 7,500 feet up here. We wonder how the altitude is going to affect these drivers when they get in town.
That's a great point. It's very different up here. You know, you can get out of breath on a quick jog if you're not careful.
I'm out of breath right now.
I'm out of breath sitting down. Exactly. And that will affect the way they play. It will affect the way they cognate as well behind the wheel. You have to be so conscious, constantly listening and constantly adapting to how your car's behaving on track. A little delay there can cause massive problems on track.
So remember,
the conditions are hard here.
Commando started at the bottom. He's moved all the way up to second. Craviator, you can see him right there in your picture on the left-hand side. He started out in eighth. So those are your two big movers right now, with Type R just running away in that Brat. We'll see if these F-150s can catch up.
In the dry, Type R managed to get to that lead, right? And we've seen maybe the Brat, that little Subaru, starting to wilt now the track's wet. But once the supercars start to charge through, it's been the story of JSR. We've got these two teammates. We've got Commando and, is it Rossi as well? Craviator, excuse me, popping up into second and third. It's now a JSR 1-2-3 in this race. They're looking so strong as a team at the moment.
I think we called Rossi and told him you're no longer going to participate in team racing because he's been that dominant.
We have to nerf him.
This is sort of, I'm not saying this is their B team, but maybe this is their truck specialist team. Lap 4 of 7 around Hockenheim, and You can tell the rain has really made a difference here, Allie.
And it's still coming down. You can see the track remains glossy. It's got a little film of water across the top, and that's just affecting the car's mid-corner. It's when the deep puddles start to form, and they often form on the apexes of corners, that you really have to start worrying about things like aquaplaning. That's when the car hops over the top of a puddle and absolutely stops steering, absolutely stops responding to anything you're doing. You'll be going straight on at that point.
Down to the north curve one more time, coming across the start finish line. Ooh. And up on the side, that's Mr. Jack tumbling.
Diablo as well, the same trick for Diablo. Too bad for those two.
Can they recover? That's the question right now. You got one all the way up on the roof of the car. Diablo able to recover, but I don't know how Mr. Jack. Turtling right now. He is on his back, able to flip it back over. But we talked about the nimbleness and how light it is, just 1,800 pounds. You bring the rain into it, you get on the inside of that of the apex there, and it just took them all the way through and actually cost two drivers some significant position.
The first corner is so fast, and you want to throw the car into it and trust the car to go into a four-wheel drift on
wow,
exit.
Wow, this damage here,
just a little pop, and that's what happens. Written in the damage on the car, that's what happens when you put too much faith in the suspension of the Subaru brand.
Red all the way around. You can see on the right side of your screen here, full damage. We'll see if they decide to pit. You know, pit normally doesn't help you, Allie, but at this point, if the car is undrivable, at least you want to enjoy. Every point matters. Even if you get to 11th, that's one more point for your team.
You've got to keep in it. You've got to keep your head up, keep your shoulders down, keep yourself with a positive outlook. It's difficult for Mr. Jack right now, but that's the professional outlook that these very, very top-level drivers are required to have.
There's Commando looking back, as he's got Craviator in his rearview mirror. Type R has literally run away with this thing. But they're starting to catch up. You can see a little bit of their lap times just getting a little bit quicker out of the F-150, trailing now by about 6 seconds or so. But it's the tenths of a second between this battle right here, Commando and Craviator, and they've had a fourth join the battle. That's TPR Chemical.
Chemical in that beautiful livery from AB Graphics. He's so able to drive these very heavy, very powerful cars. Cut his teeth in muscle car racing before he learned these skills. And now he's out here in a super truck. And that matches the same profile as a muscle car. Big, heavy, massive engine, loads of horsepower.
You know, we started this racing through the decades in the 70s. Remember that Dodge Challenger out on road Atlanta? Both of those made their debuts in 1970. But I think you're right. I think that prepares themselves for just raw power. Of course, having the all-wheel drive helps a little bit, especially in this condition.
Wow, look at this battle. These cars are so heavy. You can see them, even at a low-speed bump like that will push Craviator way out wide.
Boy.
Oh, boy. And
that's... Can we play sad tuba here as Diablo is limping himself into the pits? I think he's currently in 11th, though. Because remember, it was Mr. Jack that went full turtle. Back on lap four. It's been a pretty good race so far. We got just about over, right around two laps to go, as Davy Skills also has some damage. So I tell you what, it's not good to be a brat.
It's not good to be a brat. You get bullied around a lot. These cars are so light. If you just bump into a trophy truck a little bit. I mean, that damage for Davy Skills, that was front left suspension, front left brake damage. Not going to affect him too much. He'll be moving into the corner a little bit less certain on his brakes, a little bit less certain on turning. But he won't be losing too much speed. Not worth pitting.
At this point, does the track dry up enough to allow those brats to get back in there, or the power of these F-150s to catch Type R, who's well out in front, or is this really a battle for second right now?
You can almost forget Type R's here, right? I mean, he's disappeared, checked out at the front. He just got into the lead of this race, got his head down, locked into his racing rhythm. Bang, gone.
Boy, Revs has had a time of it. At one point, was leading this race along with Diablo. He's now in the middle of the pack. Diablo's all the way in the back with damage. As you see, Revs has moved up four spots, so you can't shame him too much for that. As we move into the final lap here on Hockenheimring, race one of two today. Coming to you from Mexico City, getting ready for the weekend Series 2 playoffs. You don't want to miss it. All kicks off on Saturday as Chemical nearly spun him around. And back with Revs now. It's both him and Sterilizer. Boy, F4H has got to come together here.
last lap of this race, and exactly all these teams need to come together. They need to work together and make sure that they can bring the positions they've fought for. Six laps now, home. It's just one more lap to go, so there's only a small opportunity to lose out.
There's only a few of our drivers out on the track that feel comfortable. Obviously, Type R is out there. He's running hot laps right now, but Craviator, Chemical, they look pretty good. There's Rebs again allowing another one go by. That's his teammate Sterilizer.
This whole race, and we spoke about Rebs at the beginning of this race, this whole watching Rebs has been giving me anxiety problems. He looks so uncomfortable in that super truck, just hanging the rear out, losing under braking. See, way too late there on the anchors. Just so uncomfortable and out of his rhythm.
It's a different feel. I know it's all-wheel drive, but you talk about the track conditions, just the overall power. And when you get down to the nuts and bolts of this thing, how much are you feathering the throttle on this thing? It's not full out.
It's not full out at all. And it's about throttle application. As you say, you feather the throttle. You give it 50%, 70% mid-corner. But you're doing that all in response to the feel of the weight of the chassis moving across the suspension. If it all falls onto the outside tire, you're just going to slide. You have to keep the chassis kind of bubbling there, not quite applying all of its weight onto its outside tires.
I'll tell you what, at one point, Type R ran a 204. That was before the rain came down. Running 206s right now. So even with the wet conditions, as you see him come across with the win here, Chemical looks like he's going to finish second. Commando behind him. So those are your top three. Not a bad race so far. So Type R logging in those 20 points. Chemical, Commando, Davy Skills, Craviator. I'd really say that's the comfortable line. All those guys felt pretty comfortable out there. When you get below, it was the confidence was shattered at times around Hockenheim.
I mean, at the start of this race, Revs and Diablo had 1 and 2 locked out. They had it all to lose, I guess, but they had it all to win as well. It was their race. It was just a small mistake from Revs that broke up that pairing and allowed other people to charge through.
And we mentioned we recorded that just a couple weeks ago. So I love the quick adjudication. Bada bing, bada boom, race number one's in the books.
You know, I think it's an interesting point to make that we were just talking about it on chat too, is that racing in the rain, Scott, you brought it up at the beginning of that race, that here in Mexico City, we have seen rain about 4 or 5 p.m. each and every one of those days. And so it's really setting a tone for what we could see for these races here this weekend in Mexico City, especially knowing that you and the community get a chance to vote with our polls with that wet, dry conditions at watch.forzarc.com.
That's the time every day that I end up taking a siesta.
That's a word that I do know.
I
learned yesterday at lunch with you guys what that was. I had no idea that was an afternoon nap.
I need my afternoon nap, man. You're down in Mexico City. You got to win in Mexico City, win in Rome, whatever the saying is. You got to take a siesta.
All right, the leaderboard. Let's go ahead and take a look at what this is all leading up to here with the global leaderboard and with the Series 2 preview races.
Yeah, here we are. These are our team points right now. Obviously, a great job by JSR, especially Type R and Commando jumping in there. And Craviator, who started at 8th, moved up, and he grabbed some great points. So 40 straight off the bat, TPR hot on the hills, but F4H, TX3 did not look comfortable on the track.
Yeah, TX3 lost out right from the start, right? We called them out at the beginning. Maybe these drivers are a little bit lower ranked than the drivers of the other teams. And yeah, slipping back in a first lap accident. TPR, Chemical, what a great job he did, pulling his team along with that move up to second.
An interesting storyline here this weekend is JSR, right? And that is the fact that the Commando is not on board with us here this weekend in Mexico City.
Did qualify. I think he's actually taking a little bit of a gamble. I mean, it does look like he's going to be in London. He's going to be on his home turf with a chance to be in the World Championship. But really, anything can happen this weekend. A bit of a gamble there by Commando.
He's such a fast racer. I mean, we've seen it week on week, right? We always call him out expecting him to win. He's had some bad luck from time to time. But
true. Very true.
Such a fast driver. I so hope to see him in London.
Well, we know that he is trying to make sure that he is here, there in London. And he actually had a chance to sit down with our reporter that will be there in London for the World Champs, Lottie Van Prague, and talk a little bit about a new series that's coming to town.
We caught up with a duo that have never met face to face. A design legend in livery artwork, FLG, and the Welsh Forza Pro Commando. Let's meet them to see how things went.
Hi guys, I am Lottie Van Praag and I am joined by a livery legend, the FLG, and a Forza legend, Commando. We actually are meeting for the first time to talk about the Forza RC driving the design series. Can you explain to us a little bit more about the series?
Basically, it's five artists paired up with five FRC drivers, and we was tasked with creating a personal design for that specific driver. We had like conversations and given information related to that driver to try and build a livery around that specific person.
This is your designer right here, yeah. Sitting next to you. Yeah. You know, the power is in his hands. When you knew that you were having your own artist for your car, yeah. What was your initial reaction? You're like, right, I need to get this right.
I was thinking, who was it going to be? That was my first thing. Who is it going to be? Who's it going to be? Because I know Jason's paint style, and that is right up my street.
So, Commander, when you're looking for artwork, yeah. What do you look for? What is your design taste?
I like something with a bright colour, but I also like it to be nice and neutral with the whites and the blacks. I like it to look realistic, as in a race livery as such. Like, I like the fancy liveries, but it's not my style. I like to have something that looks more racy on track.
You let your driving speak for itself.
Yeah. But I still like to look nice and sleek. Yeah.
How hard was it to design this car for Commando?
It took me a while to figure out what I'm going to do, but once we had the conversation and I found out what I found out, something clicked.
It's your eureka moment.
Yes, yeah. I was on the walk home from work and I was like, that's it.
Well, I think it's probably time we should actually maybe have a peek at what this looks like. Are you nervous?
A little bit. Yeah.
I've been wanting to see this for a long time.
Right, FLG, let's have a look. Okay. Oh, look, the tension's rising.
Hopefully, in the image there, you'll see the elements that from our conversation, why I've done what I've done.
Yeah.
And also, I'm pretty sure you know what that is.
Oh, yes.
And there's even a little...
Oh, beautiful touch.
That took many, many layers.
And that.
It's only... Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
So, Commander, how do you feel about driving that?
Oh, I look forward to it. I'm looking forward to seeing it in the game as well. Because it looks good on the phone, and I know it looks a lot better in the game.
What do you reckon the reaction from other race drivers, from other fans and people who will be viewing this at home?
Well, it's great. It's one of a kind, isn't it? Like, you get somebody doing something and it's just for you. I think they all feel just as good as I feel. Like, I can't wait to get a livery on my car, to be honest with you. One of a kind.
There you go, that's all we could ever hope for. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me and for meeting for the first time, being able to see this incredible artwork. Thank you so much for joining us, guys, and we hope you enjoy Mexico.
Well, an incredible interview that was. It's neat to be able to meet Lottie for the first time, too. And more importantly, did they not tease you so much that you want to see what that was?
First of all, I feel like I need to go work out after seeing Commando. That guy's a beast. But yeah, I mean, it's all about these liveries. I mean, for us to see these design and the amount of times that these guys put into it, and what a better partner to have painting your car than FLG, one of the greats.
It's one of the wonderful things about seeing racing on Forza as well, you know, the bright liveries that all the teams make, and we'll see it this weekend as well with, all the amazing paints these teams put together for themselves.
What I loved was driving through the decades and seeing the different liveries for each of the decades. That, to me, was super special and so amazing to see the talent of these artists that I was shocked. And each and every time how different they were for each decade that we had. It was really, really
special. That's the cool thing about Forza is you have so many, you have the community, but you have communities inside the community. Mm-hmm. And a lot of these guys don't even get out and really race a lot, only get out on the track to see the creation that they've created. And it's, we've made a few liveries from time again, and it is not easy.
It's not easy at all to put them together. We saw actually Topher out in the recap show as well, you know, the TX3 painter. They get out every now and again, but maybe not quite on pace. Topher out there a few weeks ago. It's great though, isn't it? The community is within the community. Mm-hmm. And it takes, you know, there's a reason why they've got three letters in front of their name, a lot of these drivers, because they have a team painter, they have team engineers, they have team drivers as well. It's all specialisms that come together to create a super, super fast and beautiful team.
Yeah, we're all dying to see this. It's driving the design, and it's actually a five-part series, really specializing and really focusing on the drivers and the designers. And I am so excited to see what's in store for this new series coming out of Forza RC.
What happens when you take an artist and a driver from Forza RC and pair them up? This is Driving the Design. Forza Racing Championship is the premier racing esport, featuring top drivers from around the world. Just as compelling and competitive is the community of Forza RC artists. These individuals transform shapes and patterns into progressive works of automotive art. We selected five drivers and challenged Forza RC artists to create a custom livery to capture their unique personality. Let's take a look at who's paired up. Sean Arnold, gamertag Commando.
Well, Commando looking sharp. This is huge.
Like that.
JSR.
Jason Backhouse, Forza gamertag the FLG.
You know, if you're a car lover, then, you know, do you want to just drive around in the box-handed red car or black car?
Fair enough. I heard that, like, one of your favourite era of cars is the 90s.
Yeah, it's nice to know that you're driving a car which looks good. I like to keep it more realistic, more of a racing vibe.
Yeah.
But I also like it to stand out a little bit, even if it's just a bit of chrome or maybe a bit of chrome red. I don't want to be driving around in a fully chrome car, you know, but make it look clean as well.
What's your favourite number?
It'd be the 787.
I hope you enjoy what I've produced. It was just about the character of him on the car. It wasn't about sponsors. It wasn't about decals and numbers. There's no rule book. I mean, I can just do whatever I want.
Artists, women, men, everyone, so talented. No one wants to drive a stock car. No one wants to drive a black red box either. And if it wasn't for these designers, my goodness, what a different world Forza RC would be.
I want to know, the cool thing for me is kind of the story behind the driver. I mean, obviously, Forza livery guy, FLG is going to do an amazing job, but 787, is that a nod to like the Mazda, a little 787B? I want to know more behind the story. Very cool series.
I think it is. I think it's a nod to the 787B, and I love the Welsh Dragon on there as well. It's so Commando, isn't it? I was thinking, I'm going to have to just call him the Welsh Dragon from now on whenever I see him on track. It's just brilliant.
Well, I think that's what this series is all about, really, Scott, is getting to those nitty-gritty and those answers to why 787, why did he go with that color combination? What is it about that car in particular, whatever it might be? And what's also interesting, the dual part of this series is the fact that we have driving the design, which to me is what I love. Like you're saying, Scott, I'm all about the stories, and I'm all about understanding why someone did X, Y, and Z, and it's really to better understand the stories behind the designers as well. How cool.
Amazing. I mean, we got 36 drivers coming to Mexico City actually later on today, and they all got a story, you know. And I know we're looking at just a few of the guys that we have out there in the FRC, but everyone's got a story to tell.
It's going to be so interesting to see, isn't it? Because some of those stories, they collide with each other. Yeah. Some people get along really well. Other people, they may clash a little bit on track. So those personalities, they come out in the liveries, they come out in the type of driving they do. It's all the stuff that makes the Forza Racing Championship so interesting.
Well, of course, Behind the Design is out already on social media, so you can make sure to check that out. You don't want to miss out on anything that FLG has to say and how he pulls everything together. And of course, Commando, listening to what he says and why that's really his influence. We'll have four more pairs coming your way as we make our way to the World Champs in London. Stay tuned for all of those episodes. They're going to be really fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the other thing is I love to get in there and paint. So it's almost like an inspirational thing for me, too, is get into the mind of these incredible painters that we have in the community.
It's always such a flop for me when I try and do that. I get so inspired looking at like an FLG paint, and then I'll hop into the livery designer. It's like it just looks like someone's thrown eggs at a car. Awful.
He's good at the Pollock designs. Everything looks Pollock coming from Allie.
Oh my gosh, you guys just cracked me up. Well, let's take it back here to Mexico City. And the important thing to note is that earlier in the week, I had mentioned at the top of the show that things got heated. And what I didn't mean, we weren't arguing, we weren't upset.
Wasn't that not an argument?
but we really got to know Mexico City a little bit more, checking out the sights and sounds with a local Forza aficionado, Bacarito, did I say that right? Bacarito.
Better than I
nailed it. Yeah, that was awesome.
And he is a guy who knows this place better than anybody that I've met so far. And he also had a chance to take us outside to the marketplace for something that I like to call a quesadilla.
Quesadilla.
Quesadilla?
Quesadilla. Quesadilla.
That was just one of the many things that we saw at the marketplace.
Starting to get pretty hungry, guys. You're supposed to meet somebody.
Hi, guys. How are you? I'm Maturito. Welcome to my town.
Perfect for a restaurant suggestion.
Yeah,
oh,
where should we go?
You should make me a lunch. And I want quesadilla.
So we have to work
one quesadilla. Yes.
Yeah, sure. We're guests in the country. Why not work for our food? Sure.
So we can go to the market and get the ingredients for my quesadilla.
What would go in your quesadilla?
Like corn, cheese, and mushrooms. So let's go to the market and get the ingredients.
Okay.
This way, right?
No. This way.
Are two very different colors.
These are the good ones. This is the typical corn tortilla for quesadilla. You can say whatever.
He's telling you to get the green one. Get the green one.
I'm confused.
I feel
green.
Like we're defusing a bomb here. The green one.
You can get this chicken and put tomatoes, and then the tortilla. It's like a taco. But the magic is flipping the tortilla.
Ooh. Oh, watch out, boys. I'm gonna be flattening your chicken. Bossame, Juanita.
Don't pound my chicken.
Don't you touch my chicken.
We can have the mushrooms and the flowers for the
mushrooms and quesadillas?
Yeah, mushrooms.
What is this world we're living
in? The quesadillas.
We don't do that in the States. Flowers?
Flowers, yeah, flowers. Like, we call it flor de calabaza.
This is beautiful. This is absolutely stunning.
Here's the mushrooms.
Are those flowers?
No. The flowers are that one.
I've seen vegetables before.
These are flowers, my friend. Different than Taco Bell.
I'm married.
Oh. No. You can put these.
What do these taste like? Can you taste?
You have to cook it.
Oh. Yeah, queso. You dip that in the queso.
Salty. Yes.
I'm gonna do it just because I wanna see what this is all about.
It's onion for sure.
Are we able to share?
Onion on your quesadilla, really?
Onion on the quesadilla, trust me. No change? Oh, discount.
I don't know if I found enough cheese. I can go back and get more cheese.
We don't need a lot of.
I'll get some more cheese.
Get some more cheese.
You should try this one.
It's very small and cut.
Would you like me to hold your cheese?
I need a cheese holder for this.
I got the cheese holder.
This looks to me like it's gonna be hot.
No.
No?
No, not at all.
Just like a little bite.
No, a big bite.
Flex your muscles while you're at it.
Okay, nothing, yeah. I'm just absorbing my life spirit.
Your face is getting a little
bit there. Yeah, no, okay.
Are we in Mexico or are we in?
I think we've actually descended into hell now, I think we're in hell. now again. It's starting to get quite hot now.
Do you want some?
I feel as though I was misled.
I have some
slightly.
Chicken.
Do we have milk?
I'm going to have some thyme. I'm going to take some thyme. A man gave me a cup of milk.
Wow.
Yeah.
Milkman in Mexico.
It's the best day of my life.
You look like you.
I don't know, guys, but I'm starving. I don't know you, but.
Yes.
Maybe we should go.
When you found us, we were hungry.
Yeah. I'm starving, so maybe we should go and make your creation.
Let's go.
Okay, let's go.
giggling away. That was hot chili.
You got stuck with the sandwich and the hot chili. I'm not sure, and the milk for that matter.
Yeah, I'm just becoming like the sort of, the trash can.
Human
I guess
disposal.
In the ForzaRC.
Out of curiosity, how confident were you guys knowing that this quesadilla, or whatever you called it, and anything else?
What was not shown was the choice of the pineapple.
What?
And I like that they didn't do that because when we come back around, I think the pineapple is going to be key. When we finally cook these quesadillas.
Yeah, an important element of the story there is Scott's pineapple, for sure.
How confident were you at that point?
Highly confident, And I remained highly confident throughout the competition.
You seem like confidence never wavered. Obviously knew what a quesadilla or quesadilla, whatever it was that you said, was.
It can't be that hard, right?
All right. Part two of that's coming up in just a bit. But right now, let's get back to racing because we're the Forza RC. Gentlemen?
Yeah, race two. Race one looked pretty good, except for some, we had a few tumbles in there with the Brad, but I think race two is going to be a little bit more on the fair side when we talk about these 12 racers that we did a couple weeks ago back when we were hanging out in Seattle with F4H.
Yeah, that's right. It's going to be a little bit of a different race. We're not going to be, I think, in the wet this time. A dry day, Road America.
We need that.
Yeah, we need that. Yeah.
You do love Road America.
I do. It's one of my favorite tracks out there. Great chances for overtaking. You love Road America too.
It's so amazing. Yeah.
And it looks like it's like a huge campus, right? You can, yeah, there's a huge amount of barbecue and cool car culture stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. It's one of the best tracks. I know you're a VIR guy, but it's one of the absolute best tracks in the United States of America. Thank you for appreciating it as well.
That's right. It's not Brands Hatch, I'll grant you.
Oh, it's okay.
Oh, goodness. All right, guys, race number two about to come your way here. And we'll see if somebody can catch up in the points here. These are the cars that are going to have a chase to choose from. We got that Ridgeline. It's a Baja truck. The Primus Prowler, Godspeed to anybody that chooses that one. And then a little Mini Cooper action in that John Cooper Works GP.
Yeah, fuck a little Mini. That's great to see out there. A big truck again. And that Prowler, yeah. It's not a car that I was aware of, I didn't think, before this.
Down here, they would say no bueno.
No bueno. Yes.
That car has no bueno.
So it's good then.
Yeah, yeah, very good. You're catching up.
Yeah, yeah. I'm really getting the language.
All right, let's see what track he's going to end up sending these three behemoths out on. That's the cool thing about this team racing. It's like, who are you going to put in the Prowler?
Yeah, yeah.
I hate to put it that way, but like, who's going to get the bad news of being in the Prowler?
But you're right. It's a tactical game. You know, you've got drivers who are going to prefer cars that oversteer, so slide at the rear, cars that understeer, slide at the front, and you want to put drivers into cars that they're comfortable in, otherwise they're going to get off the track. See what happened to Revs last race.
Well, we saw some guys able to handle that F-150. I would take some of those guys from the top of that last race, and I would put them in the truck, because a lot of those guys, like Craviator and Chemical, they seem really comfortable in the big F-150.
And that's all about being able to handle that body roll, that massive amount of weight moving across the car. It's like we were saying, you know, Chemical cut his teeth in muscle car racing. Very similar, soft suspension. Those basically agricultural vehicles. Very specific technique.
What are you expecting out of these vehicles here on Road America, one of your favorite courses?
Yeah, it's not a track. I mean, this is the full circuit we're looking at here. I think we're going to go into this smaller west route.
Yes.
And so it's not a track which is going to have as many straight lines as maybe the full circuit, which means you're going to be more about cornering speed. That's going to play against the drivers in the big trophy truck because that's all about power, all about straight line, all about high speed. It's all down to the Mini, really.
Well, here's your grid. Type R looked awfully impressive in that first race, so he's going to be in P1 to start this thing off. A Chemical, Commando, David Skills, Craviator. Now the question is, can those guys in the back, Diablo, Revs, can they help F4H get back into this? Or is it truly a two-team race between JSR and TPR?
And I'm fascinated to see what TX3 can do in this second race. Such a disappointing performance for them in race number one, falling back on lap number one. What can they do to recover this competition for themselves?
Well, they'll be running in 9th, 11th, and 12th, so they got some making up to do. And we are all green here on the western route of Road America up in Wisconsin. Get your cheese ready as we have a few. Okay, take some liberties with the track to start it off. And, you know, we have a lot of tracks, Allie, that you can firmly go two or three wide. I don't think this is one of them.
This is a very thin track. Road America actually has some great opportunities for overtaking, but the smaller west route really challenges the drivers to go side by side. There's so little runoff on the edges, you can see. You're getting so easily into the tire barrier.
Well, it's going to be 8 laps here in our final race of the day, all leading up to the weekend. Saturday and Sunday, we get kicked off on Saturday at 1 p.m. local time. And what do you think right now? I mean, track limits, question mark?
It's always tempting on lap one to sort of extend a corner, run over an apex. Just do whatever you can to keep your car scratch-free, dent-free, nice and fresh, and not being bumped by other drivers. Braking zones are the hardest places for it, so if you can take a line that maybe isn't the track, people might not bump into you.
Well, thus far, we've already seen the Primus Prowler, say that 3 times fast, falling back into the middle of the pack. I'm used to seeing it in a purple. I'm not even going to attempt to say a purple Plymouth flower. There I go. And off on the side, there is Rev once again. They put him back in the truck, something I felt like he didn't do well with in race one.
You know, maybe he was like at the end of the race, he was like, you know, I get the feel of this. I got this, guys. I finally
Lies.
Got it.
Lies.
Rev sliding off there in lap number one. That's a shame to see F4H struggling once again, although Sterilize is in fifth. And Diablo is in eighth position.
Well, all that chaos going on, there's Chemical, who apparently is just the god of truck racing all of a sudden, racing around in that Honda Ridgeline. And there's a bump from behind from Sterilizer, and he loses the back end. And Zermatt looking to go by in that Mini Cooper, but Sterilizer's doing a nice job recovering.
I'm not seeing any of the teams here managing to put together what I call a team ride. That's when they work together, help each other out to go faster around the tracks. So it's really a very individual race for a team race.
You saw a little bit of that from F4H in our last race where, hey, if they could have just stayed in the middle of the pack and got some decent points, instead, they pushed their luck. And they had, especially Diablo, after he flipped his Brad up on the roof, that really cost him. Lap 2 of 8, got Colin Alley-Tack with you here in Mexico City. These are some races we did a couple weeks ago in our team racing, but of course, this is new to you. This is new to me. This is the first time I've seen it.
And we've got some prizes for the winners here as well in this team competition.
Little Forza Horizon, get it early.
No, not bad at all.
I'm still waiting for my copy. Brian, if you're listening out there, I know he's over in Goodwood, putting in some good work. I can't wait to see Brian this weekend. Of course, in the community, they know him as Mechberg, the community manager. He does such a great job. Riding along with Sterilizer right now in that Prowler. Godspeed, my friend. There's just nothing to this.
Bubbling away on the front tires. I do quite like that in the Prowler. It's got a big behind, though, hasn't it?
It's maybe the worst boot, as you would say, in the history as they go underneath the Speedville Bridge. There's nothing better than some Johnsonville brats as you make your way around Road America. Yeah, over in England, do they have brats? Do you know what a brat is?
I have no idea what that is.
It's like a jazzed up hot dog. I could go more into it, but they end up putting it in a highlight package. And we'd have to watch it later, so I'm not going to go too deep into it.
A food stuff. We don't want any of your American food stuff, so we want perfectly good food.
So Ty Parr, we didn't see, he lost a position there back in the second place. Commando's doing a pretty nice job compared to the rest of the Prowlers hanging in there. So we actually have three different vehicles, three different teams all running up front here with Chemical. Boy, how good has he looked through these first three laps, Allie?
Chemical's looking strong on his own. He's looking very composed in that trophy truck. But I got to tell you, I was saying earlier on, none of the teams are driving together. That's changing now. JSR has started to bubble to the surface. Second, third,
yep.
And fourth. All the Jap Speed racing crew.
You called for it, you got it. And so Type R, you have Commando up there as well. And I tell you what. Hey, what do you got for us?
You guys were just talking about the fact that Chemical looked really strong, especially those first three laps. It was interesting on chat, DT underscore OLW52 says, Chemical looks scared in the driver's seat. You agree?
He's got an interesting, scary driver's suit on, right? It's like, that's up with a mummy, I think. So yeah, looks
yeah,
some scared.
He needs to upgrade. He needs to get the rewards. He needs to upgrade to the karate style that's coming out in their new rewards. As they come around that final curve, back to the start-finish line. And of course, a big shout out to GT, WOL52, who's always hanging out with us in the chat. You got your regulars, and that's what I love about not only the community of the regular drivers that we see on a week-to-week basis. We already talked about the painters today, but it's really those community members that continue to come back in each and every week. This is one of the reasons we do it as you're riding along with Commando. Once again, he's got Cravier in his rear view. Wes Alt course, and it's interesting to see, normally we have a car that, or a group of cars that rise to the top, but we mentioned before, you have the truck, the Mini Cooper, and the Prowler, all 1, 2, 3 right now.
That's right. The truck in front, driven by Chemical, has looked so composed in recent weeks. He's got great momentum heading into the playoffs. They'll be starting on Saturday. It's 1 p.m. local.
1 p.m. local time, as we mentioned. Well, 1:38 right now for Craviator. He's the fastest out on the grid. Currently running along in fourth there. There's a little love tap.
Pushing Type R wide. That's teammates. That's Commando. Starting to get a bit greedy. He's saying to Type R, you know what? Maybe I've got a little more pace than you. Maybe I can stretch my legs a bit if you get a sub.
And this is the point where you do have to just let your guy by if you feel confident. But really, those the Mini Cooper and the Prowler very evenly matched here through our first five laps. But there's Commando once again. You wouldn't think these two guys are teammates right now.
You wouldn't at all. Commando, he's looking at the rear of that Mini and just holding his foot down to the gas. No lift whatsoever. So Commando looking to find his way past his teammate to attack Chemical. Firefighters having none of it, though.
Yeah, I mean, drafting's very effective out on an oval. I don't know about here at Road America. Not much to draft off when you're behind a Mini Cooper.
it's not the most aerodynamic shape, I guess, so maybe a big old vacuum left behind in the air. Chemical's starting to disappear up the road, though. For me, that's the whisper of an extended gap now, with Commando beginning to get into Type R and disrupt that JSR pairing in second and third.
Well, that's what you want when you're out in front. You'd love for second and third to start battling against each other. Unfortunately, these guys are both teammates. Helping out TPR Chemical as they continue to battle between Type R and Chemical. Chemical just ran a 138.713, so maybe he does have a bit more pace out on the track here in Wisconsin.
He's trying to put it down. Maybe he's trying to have an answer here for the JSR pairing, who, you know, when they get along, the JSR pairing can catch up. We've seen that. But now they're disagreeing a little bit. Commando's managing to stretch his legs. He's finding pace he didn't know he had. And maybe he's relaxing a bit as well. He's saying, you know what? They haven't got their stuff together behind me. They haven't got themselves sorted out, so I can just put my foot down and disappear.
Yeah, well, with JSR right now running second, third, and fourth, you have to be careful here because you pretty much, at this point, have the team competition locked up that we're having here today. I know Chemical's looking for that 20 points. That's going to help TPR, but the rest of his gang is running a little further back with, I believe Davey Skills is running along in sixth or seventh place. And so when you're 1, 2, 3, that's a lot of points right there and should be enough for the win.
It's true. I mean, maybe low stakes here, but JSR Type R makes a little mistake there, running wide in turn two or three, I think, on this layout. And that's Commando through. But maybe 2.5 laps remaining, Commando can close that gap.
See that Prowler with a lot of power when you got some chances to stretch your legs. With the Mini Cooper, as you move through the turns, able to catch up a lot quicker. So they've swapped spots. Let's see what that does here in lap number 6 as Commando takes the lead just for a moment. Ooh. In the battle of JSR boys.
I got to say, when all of these drivers are racing for a copy of Forza Horizon 4, they're getting a little bit rough with each other. They're going to be wanting to just hold that back a little bit and safeguard their early access to that game.
I had the opportunity to play some Forza Horizon 4 with Ludacris. Good times.
Your good buddy Ludacris.
Just my good friend Ludacris. When you're down in Mexico City, you need to drop a few names. I figure he'd work in just about any country. What do you feel now? You got Commando riding along his second. I don't see much of a change as far as catching up with Chemical.
I can't see it happening. The JSR drivers have just gotten too much into each other. It's the same battle we're seeing here repeated in 5th and 6th. That's Zermatt in the Mini threatening up at F4H Sterilizer in 5th place. The Mini and the Prowler very close in pace. And there you go, Type R back through again as we go into Canada Corner.
So if you can do your quick math here, they're running 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. TPR is running 1st, 6th, and 7th. I know that 20 points is a lot, but I still think Zermatt and Davey Skills are going to have to make some moves there in the middle of the pack.
12.
Nice.
Thanks. there were little numbers and equations bouncing in the air while you were talking.
And you just throw
pretty
a number
sure,
out.
Pretty 12. Sure 12, yeah. Yeah. Pretty sure.
Lap 7 of 8 as they go underneath the Corvette Bridge. And Type R and Commando have swapped spots in 2nd and 3rd, but all they've really achieved is allowing Chemical and either further lead. And I called him the truck god earlier in the race. How good is Chemical in this ridgeline? And we saw him in the F-150 before. What is it about these trucks that allows Chemical to really have some success?
We've talked about the trucks, you know, talked about how he can manage the power and weight of that body, how he had his experience in muscle cars, and that's where he came from, that's why he's so fast. But I think what this victory really is a victory of strategy for Chemical. He's been the person most able of any of the drivers to choose a car which suits his preferences as a driver.
Final lap here of the day. A little team racing in Mexico City. Of course, the playoffs get going on this weekend. All starts on Saturday at 1 p.m. Of course, there is some group stage racing on Friday, and you can get caught up with all that going on social media about which we're going to go 36 to 24 to 12. That's what we'll be doing this weekend. Of course, passing out 75 grand, that's not a bad way to spend some time in Mexico.
Yeah, that's no small prize at all, is it? You know, loads of these drivers flying in from all over the world, and we'll be seeing people who've never raced in the same room together racing suddenly side by side, and maybe reaching over and giving each other a pinch behind the ear.
Speaking of that, Tobin Racers, Lee just posted the fact that the Forza RC S2 playoffs with a Mexican flag have become a reality. Looking forward to it. Not so much the flight, though. Many of these guys are coming from all over the world. He just posted that on Twitter with a picture of his plane. And we're so excited to have so many of those guys joining us, 36 of them, here this weekend in Mexico City.
Well, I tell you what, those that actually live in Texas probably have the shortest commute because you talk about, I know we're in the Latin region and those guys want to hold it down here like a fat kid on a blanket, but you're coming 4,000 miles from Brazil. I mean, that's quite the journey as well. As we're coming around the final corners here, boy, it's Chemical looked well. Zermatt getting off on the side there in the final curve, but it's all Chemical here in our final race of the day. Truck God confirmed.
Runs the line between the two JSR drivers, and Type R and Commander are going to go across almost simultaneously. I couldn't call it.
No, it was so close. We'll have to wait for the results. And a few love taps there at the end. I'll be honest with you. I love this team racing. And it was actually Commando that ends up finishing second. So he waited his time, waited his turn, and he's going to get the extra 3 points. I guess that's some bragging rights back in the garage.
And we can be critical of JSR's team right there, but the stakes were very low for them. They knew coming second, third, and fourth would be the best team effort out there. So it doesn't really matter which order they came in inside that.
How about Rev's 30-second penalty? And I think some of that is... I know, hey, it's a Baja car. Maybe you want to go a little off-roading, but that's going to cost you 30.
I remember at the last Wednesday show, Revs was really having a hard time with the truck. He was really good in the Porsche, but he was not so solid in the truck, and that was his takeaway, that he really needed to get out and practice more. That was a big conversation we had. Was practice for him.
Yeah, and his team leader, F4H Diablo, was right there. So he's the guy choosing the cars, who goes in what. And I guess maybe Rez had been stealing his chips all night.
Something
the previous
like that,
night.
Right?
Yeah.
Someone drew the short straw, and I think it was Rebs in these final two races.
Well, I know he was really happy about that first race, though. He did take home the win for the fastest in that class, but it was interesting to see him in his disappointment, if you will, in the truck and how it ran on the track.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it was a great choice of cars. Big shout out to Race Boy and the team out there choosing those vehicles, because you did have three different cars. Normally, we don't see that. We mentioned before, normally the faster cars will rise to the top.
Yeah.
But no, I mean, each of those cars played to the strengths of the drivers.
Exactly, and in Hockenheim as well, it was only when the rain started to fall down that we saw one car become dominant. Before that, both cars were at a very similar pace. Here at Road America, same story again. Very even, awesome to see.
Well, of course, it's time now for those final results, and JSR is one team that I think would have to be exceptionally excited knowing that what they are going home with, as you put it.
Yeah, it's awesome. FH4, how cool is that?
They have a tremendous challenge, they're a tremendous team. 77 points. It doesn't matter who they roll out there. This is sort of the B team, and I put that in quotes as they're not showing me, but it doesn't matter who they roll out there. JSR is really strong when it comes to this team racing.
They're also a team with a lot of Scottish drivers. No Scottish drivers in this lineup, but Rossi and Sal certainly coming from Scotland. I think Razor JDM as well. And Forza Horizon 4's got a few Scottish bits. It's got a few English bits as well to make Type R and Commando feel at home. Craviate's going to be on the other side of the world, though.
Let's give a tip of cap to Chemical there. I mean, I know this team finished second, but he looked really strong out there with not only a first there at the end, but also a second place position finish there in that first race.
And I think it's really one thing to note is the team chemistry and having that backing. And what we saw actually with Box, even in Series 1, having Noble behind him. And I think having that team chemistry and these team races coming into a playoff championship like this is really going to help with momentum, with camaraderie, and how important that is, knowing that a big weekend like this really does, it is determined by team too.
And that makes me think of all the team captains who come along. And a few of them feel that they're not maybe as fast as their other drivers. I mean, I know that Diablo sometimes talks about competitive retirement. Commando sometimes makes squeaks to the same direction. Craviator makes the same kind of squeaks. Mm-hmm. And it's so great for a team to have their captain there. And it energizes them. And so it's always wonderful, even if you can qualify in the lower half, you can still come along and do the race.
Someone has to do the paperwork. Right? We need a team leader. Someone's got to do it. But I think it helped F4H Yeah. Being in the studio with us 2 weeks ago, that I know it's not a full land environment, but they got to sit shoulder to shoulder and have the opportunity to race. I think that'll help them going into the weekend.
Well, of course, JSR is going home with a new Forza Horizon 4, which is so exciting. Of course, the early access drops Friday, and the big show comes out, if you will, October 2nd. But what's really important about that is for all you movie lovers out there, for all of those who really want to get connected with something super cool that we all know of, is James Bond. Check this out.
Get the Ultimate Edition and play 4 days early.
An incredible card pack that is. Man, that's gonna be good heaven.
I prefer my car shaken, not stirred.
Does that theme song just not really get you going?
Well, with it, you know, with the game being in Britain, this being the first card pack, I mean, they knocked it out of the park, Perfect. To be honest with you.
I'm so looking forward to it. I love all the gadgets, spinning bits, and the, you know, oil squirts out here, and all that kind of nuts stuff. Yeah, I'm looking forward to having to play with all those cards.
Well, from Britain, which will be in London and with the World Champs, back here to Mexico City, I'm looking forward to seeing what happened with our quesadilla cook-off. And I'm pretty certain everyone's going to be a tad bit surprised. But before we get to that, gentlemen, who do you think, out of the three of us, before we got to the cooking, was going to be the best?
Me.
Allie was talking a big game. He was probably the one I was most nervous about. No disrespect, Kate.
Hey, watch yourself.
But you'll have to find out what happened. I was pretty confident as well.
I mean, it was a tough challenge. I feel as though I came into it with a strong mental game. I expected both of you guys to fry under pressure.
Pun intended?
Yeah, pun intended. I did almost fry, actually,
to be fair. Your neck fried from sunscreen, my body fried by the oil that was filtering in the skillet. Let's go ahead and take a look so I don't have to explain it.
Welcome to my rooftop cocina. We're in the downtown of Mexico City.
By the way, it's gorgeous up here. Here on your rooftop.
Gorgeous is your pineapple.
And of course. It might be just to throw them off. Being next to Kate with a knife is a little scary.
If you guys can't take the heat.
Get out.
I win. You have 20 minutes to make your quesadilla. Okay, are you ready?
I was born ready.
Let's do this.
Tres, dos. Uno, go!
First of all, the jacket's coming off, guys. We're talking about being hot.
Right, so your quesadilla onions, right? That's what we're making.
You are literally making an entire town of onions.
I'm gonna make
there.
An get
to the pineapple. Yeah. The pineapple might have been a distraction. You know, I'm glad you're still focusing on the pineapple.
Here's the thing, I want to know why the, can we crack open that pineapple and just drink it and eat it, because it's really hot now. I get why people sweat on cooking.
Pineapples are for winners, okay?
Oh. Okay, my friend, I just learned today for the first time that you can actually eat flowers.
Yes.
Like this.
But so, you have to cut the flowers.
So tell me how I do.
No tips?
Yes.
No training?
All the tips and training.
She can have tips because you have a pineapple.
That's Thank true. You.
Okay. For distraction.
Yes.
I'll allow it. I'll allow it.
Woo! Ooh. I felt that cackle.
Crikey. You gotta watch out. Told you scoot over.
Did you to sabotage your cooking?
Oh, I noticed the way the wind was blowing, and I just said, hey, you gotta go for it.
Got in the first seat there.
You gotta go for it.
A potato.
Yeah.
Four?
I was comparing it to Scott's head.
Water.
Yeah, a little bit of water.
We're making a quesadilla, not a soup.
We're helping it break down. We're helping it break down a little bit.
Making a broth?
New way of making chicken. Look
at this. I was much better at patting down the chicken earlier in the market than I am.
With a spoon and a knife.
You know, sometimes you just gotta do what you gotta do. I don't even, do we even have,
don't try it at home, guys. Oh, she grabbed the chicken with her hands.
Now I have
to do it. She do it, guys. This is a miracle. Okay, guys, so now I have to try this quesadilla.
I don't know if you have to. I talked a big game. All right, just get in there. Get right in there.
No, because the chicken is the chicken is not cooked very well. So no, you failed. Sorry. So I'm happy because you touched the chicken.
Finally.
Yeah. So. Okay.
And it looks like a quesadilla, right?
It has a good body of quesadilla.
Well. That's. It has flowers in it.
You have 5 of 10.
Go on over to
Come on over to Flavor Town, my friend.
Okay. My line.
Okay. Your quesadilla looks fine.
You don't have to go for the pineapple.
Just chilling. The pineapple is just chilling.
It's just hanging out for your pleasure.
Coming out with it.
No.
No.
No. So, Kate, what do you think, guys, if we leave your quesadillas here and now we can get some real lunch?
I was robbed. That's all I have to say. I was robbed.
Literally for 3 days you've been bitter about this.
I'm upset about it still.
Bitter.
I crossed the line.
It was delicious.
Bitter party of one. Your table's ready, my friend. Go join it. I just like you as a DNF, and I won on the basis of a 5 out of 10. Are you kidding me? A 5 out of 10.
I feel like it was rigged against me. Everything was against me. My chicken wouldn't cook. I had a live chicken. They gave me a live chicken.
Hey, at least I got the pineapple in there at the end.
They made up this meal. I don't know what it's called. I don't know what it is. And they made me cook it. We're all guessing.
You guys, I'm so glad I was up against you. Thank you, Bacarito, for joining our fun there, for leading us through the Mexico City culinary scene, and for teaching Ali what a quesadilla dilla.
I'm not sure he taught me, to be fair. I don't know if I learned anything.
I learned that you are not cooking our food anytime in the near future. Okay, let's get back to some racing. We know that Mexico City is in for some really intense racing, as we just obviously had some really intense cook-offs going on. But more importantly, these three groups, over the last four weeks, really, but really this last 2 weeks, it's been really fun to see people's reactions to what groups they're in.
Yeah, I mean, I know group three is really, it's kind of the group of death. It's the hardest of three, but that's not to diminish group one and two, because there's some very strong drivers in there. Boy, this is going to be so interesting, so tough to call this weekend.
Yeah, I mean, starting out with group number one, Sal Bazoon.
Yeah, as you say, we're a long way from Brazil here, but we're in the LATAM region with this event, and he's got to have a little bit of a hometown feel. Staying in his own continent and fighting it out for a win here. So I'm so hyped to see Zoom out racing. Force One, though, he's going to give him a run.
Yeah, that's my guy. I mean, I think for him, it's just, can he put it all together? You know he's going to be aggressive. You know you're going to get some aggressiveness at a Zoom as well. And then you can't forget about your season 3 winner, Roadrunner, who's just sitting there. And I think some of the track and car combinations might actually lean toward Roadrunner in that Group 1. Should be an incredible way to start the day.
I can't wait. So, yeah, Group 1, you got to look to Zoom.
Group number 2 is really interesting as it matches up two ex-teammates, which could add a little animosity, especially since they're going to be in the same room together. But go ahead, gentlemen. What's your takeaway?
So, what, Mitch and Rossi? Or
I think that's Mitch and Rossi, yeah.
They're
yeah.
not going to go out and eat some quesadillas and patch this thing up? Or they're going to let it all happen on the track?
We've got to find out. I mean, Mitch and Rossi, I mean, Mitch previously in JSR this year, switching over to Williams later on. I think that during his time at JSR, Mitch, down there, he's in the bottom right of the screen, was one of the ones who was really threatening Rossi for that top spot in JSR. Then he ditches off, goes somewhere else, starts a whole new thing.
What lightning do you think we're going to get here in this group two? And I hate to overlook him because the youngster from North Carolina has proven all the way back to the New York Invitational 2 years ago that, hey, you get him in the LAN environment and that's when he sort of locks in and he has a little bit of mystique that can throw some of the other drivers off.
But as you say, what lightning are we going to see there?
That's right.
Not consistent. He's not there every week. Lightning, he needs to have a head game as well as a race game.
Well, I think that'll be interesting to see Lightning come out as he did in Series 1 playoffs. It was interesting because if he didn't perform well, he was not wanting to talk, he got upset. We saw that head game play a big part of it, and I think that's a really important thing to note, what kind of Lightning we will see here this weekend in the Series 2 playoffs. Okay, Group number 3. I don't want to take your thunder, Scott, but you have a specific name for Group number 3. What is it?
I mean, I'm not original at all. I think it's a group of death. I mean, you talk about a group that has Box and Lage in it just to start with. And you got some heavy hitters even down at the bottom. You talk about Craviator, Handicap in there as well, one of our LATAM guys that we saw in Series 1 playoffs. And Venom, you can't get more consistent than Venom. I think he needs to be a bit more aggressive when it comes into this Group 3, but that's the wall right there that the rest of the guys got to get around.
I mean, you're calling them heavy hitters. It's very much the traditional heavyweights from the Forza Racing Championship, Lage, Box, 7, all those three from Europe, so EMEA. This will be the first time that Venom from North America races against these European drivers. He's the only one. How's he going to measure up, you know?
Sure. I mean, that's in the community, they love to talk about the Europe being so powerful, and it's true. They have dominated, but can Venom be that one ray of light for North America to shine through this weekend?
Well, these three groups make up 36 drivers, which make up our tournament here this weekend for the Series 2 playoffs. The breakdown is...
Well, we won't see the Friday racing. There's 36 racers. Check social media for that. But it's all about getting that 36 down to the 24. And, of course, Saturday at 1 p.m., that's when it starts off in that final 24 drivers.
Correct. So it's going to be the first round, the group stage, 3 races. The semifinals will be 3 races per group as well. And the finals are bumping it up to 4 to give them a real run for their money.
And that is actually 1 p.m. local time on Sunday, not 11 a.m. That's what it is out in Seattle on Pacific time. But 1 p.m. local time on Sunday, that's when the finals start. But you can't miss Saturday.
Well, that 4th race of the finals, we know there is a lot at stake here in this Series 2 playoffs. But one big thing that's at stake, of course, is the Porsche 70th anniversary. And that is something...
Need it.
I need this
in my life.
And what a special tribute to our racing through the decades that we've had here in Series 2. It's been a lot of fun to do that, but I think this is literally the icing on the cake. I wish there was like a guacamole on the chips. I wish there was like some like that. It's what it is, the top thing here in
what
Mexico
a nod
City.
To their racing history
it's
that,
beautiful, isn't
that
it?
Porsche's had. And not only have they been a big part of motorsports, but also a big part of what we've done here. And for the winner to take home that one-of-a-kind Porsche console, that's... Of course, 75 grand is pretty good too, but you know, to get an opportunity to have something that no one else has, I mean, that's the dream.
It's so cool, right? Say a lovely tribute to their 70 years of motorsports, but also a lovely tribute to my gaming setup. So I'm looking forward to having it.
And driving the Spider, that's something that I want to make sure everyone's aware of here this weekend. The breakdown, the schedule of what's next as we're coming to you live from Mexico City. It's an exciting week as we are making our way to the Series 2 playoffs semifinals, which is happening September 29th, as Scott just explained. It's 11 a.m. Pacific, but 1 p.m. Central here, local time. And the Series 2 playoffs final, September 30th, that's Sunday, 1 p.m. local, 11 a.m. Pacific. And of course, the best place to watch, the best place to engage with us to earn those quests, to receive those rewards is watch.forzarc.com. You don't want to miss out on any of the action coming your way. And of course, Series 1 plus Series 2 is taking us all the way to London for the World Champs, and that's coming up here in less than a month, really.
Yeah.
Speaking my language, literally, here. I think I'll do better across the pond over in London. We had a great time there last year, Allie. And, you know, I think for a lot of these European racers, that's their goal. That's their goal right now, is to get the opportunity to win a championship on your home turf, something Lage didn't get to do at Le Mans last year.
This is looking so far in the future for a lot of these drivers. Sure. You know, a lot of them still have to earn their place in London. Right. It's all left to be done here in Mexico City. So yeah, I'm looking towards London. I cannot wait. But at the same time, you have to cross this hurdle first.
And don't forget, even if you're locked in London, this is your chance to move your way up the grid. You don't want to get caught in a group in the world finals that you wish, hey, if I just did a little bit better in Mexico City, I could avoided being with some of these heavy hitters.
All right, before we sign off, we want to make sure that we get the predictions of who we really feel is going to maybe not come out on top, if you don't want to give that away, but one racer who's really going to stand out to you.
I don't make predictions as the play-by-play guy, but I think it's Rocky 3 where Mr. T says pain. That's his prediction. Some of these guys are just going to really get a taste of what it's like to be on this big stage. And thrill of victory and the agony of defeat, that's my prediction.
Yeah, and you know, it's a chance for all the drivers to go out there and prove themselves, represent their regions, represent their teams, represent their friends and the community. It's a big deal for a lot of these guys, and everyone will have different expectations. A win for Lightning might look very different to a win for Sterilizer or mm-hmm. somebody else. So the wins are all out there to be had for these drivers. Like, I just can't wait to see it.
You know, for someone like Diablo, he's just like hoping that he moves on to Saturday,
right.
You know? And we've seen a lot of folks, Roadrunner kind of came out of nowhere last year, where we were like, it's Lage and Lightning. And we hit that over the head, and Roadrunner's like, meet me. Yeah. Hello, by the way, I just won the championship. What's up?
Yeah, see you later. Exactly. I can't wait.
Very interesting final thoughts. And I think I go back to Box. I'm curious to see how, after his success in Series 1 playoffs, you know, Series 2 has been interesting for Box overall. And I think that'll be a guy to watch, too, to see how he responds, knowing what it takes to get it done at one of these playoff events. Well, big thanks to all of you for joining our fun here today, putting up with us as we toured our way around the culinary scene of Mexico City. A big thanks to Bacarito for showing us the ropes here as well. Our cast and crew, Plantronics, Playseat. Everyone, we are so excited to be taking you through the playoffs live here from Mexico City. For Scott Cole, Ali Tack, myself, our cast of hundreds who have put this show on, we thank you for joining us. We'll be back with you here at watch.forzarc.com.
My quesadillas are better.
It's all about the pineapple.